Hello everyone. I am going to be doing something a bit differently today. I want to take a closer look into Thus Spoke Zarathustra in the chapter Old and Young Woman. This part of the book has many different responses, but my approach to this will be a feminine one, and maybe a bit of an irrational one too. If what I say seems wildly off the path for you, know that I am simply giving that feminine perspective, which is going to be a bit more creative, irrational, and reach into the void a bit. But remember that sometimes in the irrational, we find the targets that are not on course. Some of what I'm saying may absolutely be off course, and that is actually the intention. I simply want you to let down your defenses and experience this other perspective with me. Now, let's search for what isn't there to possibly find what is. In the one of the first lines, much hath Zarathustra spoken also to us women, but never spake he unto us concerning woman. And I answered her, concerning woman, one should only talk unto men. Talk also unto me of woman, said she. I am old enough to forget it presently. I think a word that is important here is forget. If we were to put the word forget into motion, it transforms from losing one's memory into actively going into nothing, actively stripping oneself away from expectations to begin new. What I also want to do here is that when Nietzsche uses the terms man and woman, I actually think that he means masculine and feminine. So if we read concerning woman, one should only talk unto men. It looks like he's turning her away because she's a woman, but if we look at it in the angle of concerning the feminine, one should only talk unto the masculine, and we understand that masculine represents a physical presence and feminine is a metaphysical presence, then perhaps he is turning the woman away because he thought she would take a more masculine, literal approach to trying to understand what he was saying. So it's kind of like saying, hey, if I'm going to talk about this feminine metaphysical force, you're only going to take it in a masculine, physical, literal way and not read between the lines like I'm wanting you to. Because I've found that to really get to the core of the metaphysical, it has to be done in a very roundabout way. You can't talk about metaphysics, but you can only talk metaphysically through things like parables, fictional stories, poetry, art, fleeting moments, things like that. And so going back to where she uses the word forget, I believe she's saying, no, I know what you're saying. I can go into this nothingness, this void and of the feminine and forget the logic and the structure of the masculine literal meaning to really understand what you're trying to say. And when it says that he obliged her, the word oblige cannot only mean to do as someone asks, but also be indebted or grateful to somebody. And so I think the gratefulness kind of shines through in that word if we're looking at it in this context. Everything in woman is a riddle, and everything in woman hath one solution. It is called pregnancy. Now, let's look at that line again and say it differently. Everything in the feminine, the metaphysical, is a riddle. And everything in that feminine metaphysical presence hath one solution. It is called pregnancy. Now, this gives a very different story because he is using this poetic and roundabout approach. I don't think that he necessarily means literal pregnancy. I think it acts as a metaphor for the reader because we can understand the process of a pregnancy. Pregnancy in this case would or could mean creation, and what is the process of this if we look at it? A great landmark, army, nation, all first came from the metaphysical. It is a riddle how these ideas come to us and how we exactly bridge them to the physical. There are ideas on this, but nothing can really truly pinpoint or catch it, I would say. Going to the next line, man is for woman a means. The purpose is always the child. But what is woman for man? And then again, we look at this differently. Physical masculine is for the metaphysical feminine, a means. But what is the feminine for the masculine? And then going to the next line, and changing the words again, two things want the true masculine, danger and diversion. Now let's first look at the word danger. What words come to mind when you think of danger or diversion? I know for me, I think of concepts like unstructured. Think of like a house. A house is a structure that brings us safety from the wild. The structure of a schedule helps us to stay on task and not be diverted, and meaning protects us from being uncertain. Okay, so let's look at this again. Two things want the true masculine: unstructured uncertainty and the absurd path not on course. Perhaps the true masculine is looking for that metaphysical presence. So, therefore, wanteth that feminine metaphysical force as the most dangerous plaything. For how else does the physical expand unless it sees a target that's not on course? Going on, that physical, logical masculine shall be trained for war, and metaphysical, irrational feminine for the recreation of the warrior. All else is folly. So when it says train for war, I wonder if war is actually referring to duality, dual thinking, black and white, me versus them, which physically may be essential for creating structure. And I don't mean this in like a bad way. There's not necessarily an enemy. When we build a house, we may choose brick over stucco according to the climate in order to raise the quality of our living situation. Now, the feminine allows for a recreation of that thinking that is trapped in that either or, recreating meaning, the expansion, new possibility, new ways of living, the ability to play, dream, wonder, to feel in ways that are deep and complex exist in the metaphysical. This feminine force is like a wise art that cannot be captured, but can only really be experienced, sang with, danced with. And so let's go to the next line now. Two sweet fruits, these the warrior liketh not. Therefore, liketh the woman, or the metaphysical feminine, bitter is even the sweetest feminine. I look at the phrase two sweet fruits like too many possibilities for that warrior that is duality. And of course, a mind of either or does not like that. It needs structure. So even if that physical masculine likes the metaphysical feminine, all of these possibilities in the void still feel bitter because it's a lot. We can long for danger and diversion in our lives because it gives us new ways of living, but it can also feel bitter because we enjoy that comfort of the structure. To jump into the unknown can leave a bitter taste of fear and possible regret. Better than masculine doth feminine understand children. So instead of better than man doth woman understand children. But masculine is more childish than feminine. So to me, childish is that thinking in duality. It must be this or this, which again is not necessarily a bad thing. A child itself is much more adaptable with the ability to learn many different things. For example, it's usually easier to teach children multiple languages when they're younger than it is to teach an adult a new language. Children have a lot more brain plasticity, meaning they can easily form new neural connections. They also have fewer preconceptions, so it makes sense to me that the metaphysical feminine would understand children and the physical masculine would be childish. Now I'm going to go on further using those masculine and feminine terms in the text. In the true masculine, there is a child hidden. It wanteth to play. Up then, ye feminine, and discover the child in the masculine. So instead of discover the child in the man, discover the child in the masculine. Discovering the potential, it's like discovering the potential and expansion in this physical structure. A plaything, let the feminine be, pure and fine like the precious stone, illumined with the virtues of a world not yet to come. And I think what's really important here is a world not yet come, because the metaphysical works and moves within a world not yet come. It's kind of beyond our physical reality, beyond what we can conceive. Also, before I go further, I want to make a disclaimer that I believe that we all have masculine and feminine traits. And again, when I say masculine and feminine, I'm not saying man and woman. Man and woman are more like the metaphors used for masculine and feminine, because I think it's much easier for us to picture and create our own structured ideas around it that way. The next line, let the beam of a star shine in your love. Let your hope say, may I bear the Superman. And when he says, may I bear the Superman, I think he's actually saying, let me shine a light on these new ideas and dreams that exist outside of the structure in order to give birth to them. This also makes me wonder if the Superman isn't necessarily a man or a type of man, but rather a way of being. In your love, let there be valor. With your love shall ye assail him who inspireth you with fear. Here I'm looking at valor and fear to be movements of the metaphysical feminine and the physical masculine. Fear is going to be a little more restrictive with less movement or movement away from that metaphysical presence, and valor is looking to run toward it. In your love be your honor. Little doth the feminine understand otherwise about honor. But let this be your honor, always to love more than ye are loved, and never be the second. I'm still having trouble trying to pinpoint the word love. It's almost like this vast nothingness that gives way for many possibilities. But even that isn't a great explanation, and but for now, that's kind of what I'm going with. So this vast void that is love, it honors with its irrational potential. Like, this goes way further than we could ever comprehend. It wouldn't understand how our, like, it wouldn't understand how we understand honor. I actually wonder if he's turning to the audience here in the next line when he says, "But let this be your honor." It's like he's giving instructions to the audience, like, love more than ye are loved. Maybe saying something like, don't hold back, be irrational. That is the only way the Superman can emerge. And then the last line I'm going to go over for this video. Let the masculine fear the feminine when she loveth, then maketh she every sacrifice and everything else she regardeth as worthless. And I think that fear here in this context means to restrict oneself, to step aside, to respect the metaphysical presence, to emerge and go through. Maketh she every sacrifice could be the process of finally bringing that metaphysical into the physical. So every other thing is worthless now because the process is now underway, the creation, the birth is happening. And I'm going to stop here for now and make a part two in the future, finishing up the rest of this chapter. And like I said, I may be way off the mark here, but and maybe this is not what Nietzsche meant at all, but I still wanted to get the idea out there because you never know. You never know. But anyway, thank you so much for listening. And again, I'm hoping to get a part two out soon.